product processing and marketing. He will deliver the lectures on poultry product and marketing. I welcome you, sir, on behalf of NAHEP team AU Anand and on behalf of myself. I request Dr. Rajesh Rajpura, he will give the brief introduction of Dr. Manish Kumar, sir. Dr. Rajesh Rajpura, please.
Good morning, sir. Dear participant, today we have two lectures. One is on product processing and second is on disease, impact of disease on poultry. So first lecture, we'll start with product processing. We need a person who know everything about poultry product processing. So for today morning session, we have with us Dr. Manish Kumar, sir. He's a dean at College of Veterinary Science and Animal Husbandry, Gadwasu, Ludhiana. He's graduated from Haryana Agriculture University, post PhD in livestock product technology, and he's done in further study in advanced training in meat proteomics from University of Kentucky, Lexington, USA. Sir, have wide work experience, starting from assistant professor to professor and head at Department of Livestock Product Technology, Veterinary Science College, Gadwasu. Right now, he is holding the post of dean. He has awarded with many awards, like a CSIR Research Fellowship Award from 1996 to 1998, University Merit Scholarship from 1994-96. President Fellowship, Korean Society of Food Science and Technology, Fellow of National Academy of Veterinary Science, Fellow of Indian Meat Science Association, Fellow of Indian Poultry Science Association, Fellow of Indian Association of Advanced in Veterinary Research, Distinguished Alumni Awards of Gadwasu. He attended more than 20 international meetings in USA, Republic of Korea, Thailand, Belgium, Israel, Malaysia, and India. He has 6 appreciation certificates from Gadwasu. And he's a chief editor of Journal of Meat Science and Technology since 2004. If I add more, he's elected member of this Indian Poultry Science Association from 2010 to 12. He has in his name 41 best research paper award is there. He transferred 12 different technologies to 21 entrepreneurs for the commercial approaches. He also organized a meat science conference in 2016. He joined, he organized more than 51 programs for value addition in meat and poultry. Over and above, sir have 2 patents in egg science and technology. He published more than 157 research articles. He written more than 8 books in meat science technology, 20 book chapters, and more than 200 abstracts in various conferences and symposia. Sir, your wide experience in the field of poultry product technology, and this is the need of today's era, sir. So we request Dr. Manish Kumar, sir, to deliver his talk on poultry processing. Sir, please. Sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. So I want to thank all the organizers that they have given me an opportunity to interact with the participants regarding the poultry processing as well as the marketing potential of the poultry products. So I will share my presentation over here first. Visible? Sir, is it visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir. Go ahead, sir.
So, basically, we are being discussing in the next 40 minutes regarding the poultry products processing and marketing. The basic idea regarding the poultry structure in India is that no doubt, no many...
Sir, some echo is there in your voice, so please correct it, sir. Echo is there.
Hello, now it's okay?
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
So the basic Indian poultry structure Everybody might be knowing, those are being related to the poultry industry, that India is being amongst the fifth largest poultry producer in the world. We are being producing 109 billion eggs, which are being having a value more than 45,000 crore rupees. And if you see the poultry meat structure, we are being producing around 50.34% of the total meat produced in India. That's around 4.12 million tons, and which is estimated to be size of around 85,000 crore rupees. So the poultry industry directly or indirectly contributes more than 1.3 lakh crore rupees to the GDP, and more than 10 lakh farmers have been involved. If we see the indirect benefit what the poultry industry is being providing in with respect to the agriculture, that's include the soya growers also, and the feed grower, feed manufacturers and others, all are being involved. So it is being providing direct and indirect employment to the more than 5 crore people, which is a very huge number. So if we see the how the poultry industry is being revolving in the last 7 years, so if we see that in last population statistics were being coming in 2012, at that time the growth is being around 16% is being recorded, and it's being increased from 730 million to the 852 million. But the point of concern here, you can see on the table, the lower table, that the backyard poultry farming system is being increasing. In the last almost one decade, you can see this is being in growth, is being around 45% growth is there. And the commercial system is being, no doubt the growth is still being there, but comparatively it's being very less. So this is a one point which should be noted, that the people, especially the breeds, like the native breeds, Asil, or maybe Van Raja, or maybe Kadaknath, they are being coming up in a very nice manner, and the people are accepting all these breeds for the meat purpose as well as for the egg purpose. So the growth rate is being increasing in that aspect. If we see the poultry meat, as I've already told you, that the poultry meat is being occupying around 50% of the total meat production, which is being one of the biggest consumer market is being there. Regarding the egg, egg production is almost 65% of the total egg produced in India are concentrated to the five major states. Andhra Pradesh, that's being producing highest 19.1%, Tamil Nadu 18.2%, Telangana around 13.2%, West Bengal around 8.5%, and Haryana around 6% is being there. So the commercial poultry farmers, no doubt there is a good growth rate in case of the backyard poultry farming system, but their contribution to the total egg production is being limited to less than 20%. It's 81% is being coming from the commercial poultry farmers only. The major contribution is being coming from the all these federations, which are being basically dealing with the marketing of the eggs and others. If we see the export scenario of eggs as well as the poultry meat or the poultry product as a whole, in a per se, we find that we are being exporting, the export is being increasing on a regular basis from the last 5-6 years, but still it's being limited to around 2000 crore to 2500 crore, and the highest export is to the Oman or the Gulf nations are the highest exports is being going on, because the domestic demand of the poultry product is being very high, so we have a less export, but there is a lot of potential is being there. We can then go for the export in a high manner. The demand of the livestock product, especially you can see the poultry is being increasing. We are being expecting that the poultry meat demand will be around 8.9 million tons in 2030. Which is being the almost the growth is being 844%. So in this, the point of concern is that the demand of the poultry meat and the poultry products is being more in the rural area in comparison to the urban area. So the acceptability of the poultry product is being increasing throughout India. The meat consumption ratio and everything, we find that as per the National Statistical Survey Organization, we can see that around 70% of the Indians over the age of 15, they are being consuming the meat. And no doubt, the if you see Gujarat and other part, that's being a comparatively being a greener states in the and their consumption of the poultry meat or the other products is being lower. But as per the recommendations of the Indian Council of Medical Research, that the every person should have a 30 gram of the animal protein, especially the meat-based proteins. So, however, in comparison to that, the Indians, every Indian is being getting only 17.8%. No doubt, the total meat availability to the consumers is being 6.8 kg per annum. But like the bovine meat acceptability is being very less, it is being limited to the few states, and majority of our bovine meat is being exported. So the major consumption is being the poultry meat. That's around 3.4 kg of the poultry meat is being available for each person every year, which is being competitive. It's just in a brief regarding the what is the marketing system presently prevailing is being there. So we have a direct marketing system which is being basically being meant for a small farmers or the backyard farming systems and others. They are being directly sale of the egg is being there from their farm. That's a farm gate sale counters are being coming up, or door to door sale, day sale is being there. No doubt in the direct marketing systems, there is always higher profitability is being coming up. The producer is being getting better returns, but it is being possible only in case of a small quantity and others. Otherwise, if you are being for a commercial line, we have to depend upon the organized marketing channels. Organized marketing channels that have the number of the intermediates go on increasing and the profitability of the producer go on decreasing. This is the hard fact and it's been happening. So like a producer, if it is being one is being collector as a then it goes to the merchant, then wholesaler, retailer and consumer, finally that to the consumer. So in that case, the price is being highest where the consumer is being paying highest and the producer is being getting lowest. The different poultry associations which are being existing in India, that's contributing to the marketing as well as they are being creating an awareness regarding the poultry and poultry products amongst the consumers. That's the Poultry Federation of India. Then our compound livestock feed manufacturer association, CLMFA, National Egg Coordination Committee, Indian National Federation of Animal Health, and Broiler Coordination Committee. These are the common associations which are being working in the field conditions. However, in case of the industry and others that include all the poultry products, the major issues and concerns are being the perishability and quality. It's one of the major issues. As the poultry meat is a perishable item, egg also, no doubt, egg is being gifted by God, a cell covering which protects its quality and others. But still, there's a lot of issues are being arising with the egg quality also. Their shelf life issues are being there. How we have to tackle? Then it's always being a quality is being always being a related with so many factors. And always there is a discussion regarding the residue content, different residue content, maybe the medicinal residue, pesticide or drug residues in case of all the poultry products, maybe egg or meat. Then there is a demand and supply gaps. The transportation of the poultry products throughout India. And it's a seasonal variation is also being one of the big issue. Like in case of the North India, there is some festivals like Navratras and others, the supply is being the demand of the product is being reduced like anything. And then the marketing and the consumer attitude, it influences the concern in a major way. Like the simplest way example is with us that in case of the corona crisis, the consumer attitude has been varied with the rumors surrounded around the poultry meat and the consumption rate of that is being reduced like anything. There is a huge losses the poultry industry has gone through that period. Then the byproduct utilization and the environment safety is always being an issue. It's not only at a production level where the waste at a poultry farm is being utilized. Then it's also being including the byproducts coming through the meat industry, poultry industry. That includes feathers, that include blood, the inedible portions, how it is being disposed of. They are being putting up a stress on the environment. That's the major issue. So how these issues can be managed? For that purpose, we have a lot of challenges are being there. One of them is the processing infrastructure, especially in case of the poultry meat. Majority of the poultry meat, around 89% of the poultry meat is being processed in the regular wet market or the dry processing by not following any type of the hygienic measures. On the roadside slaughter is being there, which is being the people are always going for a hot meat. They are being going and selecting the birds, and then birds are being slaughtered before their eyes. And that's a unseen, the problem associated with that, quality issues and others, that's being a really a big problem. But how we can resolve that issues? Now, the major chunk of the consumers, they are interested to have a hygienic meat, but for that purpose, we require a processing facilities. Infrastructure is being required, which is being still being lacking. Only 11 to 12% of the poultry is being slaughtered through these hygienic poultry processing plants, so-called modern poultry processing units. We have a very poor value addition technologies. If we see the value addition with respect to the development of the products or others, that's being limited to only 2 to 3%. The majority of the poultry is being, no doubt, it's being sold on the restaurant in the form of the different products only. That's a regular ethnic products are being there. Then we have a cold chain breakage. The cold chain maintenance during the supply is a biggest problem. We have a fragmented cold chain, which always causes a big problems. Then the mechanization of processes and the development of the equipment, the engineering aspect is being still being lacking. No doubt, some of the Indian companies, they are being coming up and they are being developing various equipments on that line. But still the low cost equipments for the farm gate processing or for a small farmers or maybe a small slaughterhouse or small butcher is still being lacking. Then research and development on this regard is being, especially with respect to the byproduct management, waste management, is still a lot of R&D is being required on that issue. And there is always being an acute shortage of the skilled manpower. Human resources are being there, are always being shown, short of supply. So whenever somebody is being putting up such a unit, it's always a big problem with him. Then food safety and the quality. Food safety of quality, that includes all the aspects, physical quality, chemical quality, and the microbiological quality. We have to assure the proper color, texture, toughness, flavor of the meat. Like poultry meat is always being considered as a white meat. But when we are being going for a roadside slaughter, there is bleeding is improper. There is no stunning method is being used. So you will never find a white poultry meat over there. It's always being a dark red or bright red is being there. So the how much blood is being remaining in the carcass, that's always a big source of the quality deteriorative changes. Then the chemicals, the many of the times the Indian poultry industry is being maligned with the point that there is a lot of drugs for hormones and other pesticide residues are being coming up. We have to look forward to that issues also. Then the microbiological quality, no doubt the salmonella is always being an issue many of the times, but the associated microorganisms, the spoilage organisms, which are being coming up along with the poor standards or the quality standards, it's always should be looked into that perspective. Then we have to develop the low cost preservation technologies. That should also be innovative way how it can be managed. Because as I have mentioned that there is a fragmented cold chain is being there. That cold chain is the biggest problem. So in case of that, for to maintain that cold chain, we require the capital investments. We require the regular supply of the electrical current. So how that can be managed? For that purpose, we have to develop some innovative preservation technologies that should be have a low cost also. So as food safety issue is always being a big issue, big hue and cry. It's not about the microbiological safety and the chemical safety. It's always about the authenticity of the product is also being there. The traceability. If you are being marketing your product, then you should it should be traced back to the farm level. Not only to the farm level, it to even to the last bird level. And the what the feed is being fed to the bird, it's also being a very, very important. Then halal market is also being coming up at a very huge rate, more than at the rate $200 million or the more than $2 billion halal poultry meat industry is being there. We have to go for the authentic halal certifications and other issues. The bacterial safety with respect to Salmonella, Campylobacter, or the influenza virus, all these should be taken care. Then the mycotoxins, Aspergillus, Penicillium, Fusarium, antibiotic resistance in the meat-borne pathogens, it's still the work is being going on in that regard. AMI is the next big issue in the first. So we have to take care of all these emerging safety issues. How these can be resolved? This can be one of way of resolving all these issues, the value addition. Value addition provides the sustainability to the poultry meat and the egg industry. It provides the variety. It gives the functionality as functionality in the form of the many things like we can develop the low cost formulations so that the high quality animal protein should be available to at a lowest cost to every consumer. Then we can develop the health oriented or as per our requirement designer food products that includes your low calories, low fat, omega 3 fatty acid enriched products. So we can have a bigger market area. So it can go to the highest level of the consumer as well as to the lowest level of the consumer. Means all the aspects should be covered. Then if you are being following all these aspects, including the byproduct processing of the byproducts into the high value byproducts, no doubt some of the cases we are being processing our byproducts into the form of the meat meal, meat cum bone meal or feather meal, which are being considered as a low cost, high volume byproducts, but their retainability is being less. We have to look forward. We have to develop our R&D to develop much better product in that case. With respect to the from feathers, we can develop the even the fabric is can be developed. We can go for the development of the various other products from the different byproducts. That's the need of the R. Next important thing about the marketing system is that the which is being coming up is the branding. Branding of the meat and the egg. Branding is the most important tool for improving marketability. But still it is being lacking in case of the poultry industry. No doubt, branded household commodities like wheat flour, edible oil, milk and others, they have gone a very long way. And the milk is the biggest example. It's a very important example with respect to the commodity, which has a low shelf life, perishable item. And still it is being available in various brands. That is only because of we have developed the supply chain system over there. Until and unless the supply chain system with a proper maintenance of the cold chain is not being developed, the brands cannot reach to the consumer table. No doubt many of the chilled or the frozen chicken brands are being available, but their penetration is being very limited to the bigger cities and the locations. Whereas in case of the egg, the branded egg is being very limited. It's only 2-3%, but it's one of the big markets which is being zooming up. And if we see that system, it's being moving on. The ag branding is being increasing at a compounded annual growth rate of around 12%, which is also being a very good factor. How we can move to that ag branding system. The proper graded eggs should be available. You can see the proper packaged with a clean and the clean eggs. It can be packaged in a single egg, 2x, 4x, 6x, anything, 12x or the 30x, traditional 30x tray. So the proper beautiful packaging of eggs are being available. The different varieties of the eggs are being available. Herbal eggs, cage-free eggs, in which the eggs are being produced from the birds which are being raised without any cages in a floor system. Free-range eggs, vegetarian eggs. Vegetarian eggs, no doubt, it's always been a big discussion regarding the whether the eggs are being a vegetarian or non-vegetarian. So, however, I always support that the eggs are a vegetarian because as even recently the Ministry of Animal Husbandry and others also they have called the eggs as a panchi phal. It's a fruit coming from the birds. But in our this case, the vegetarian eggs means that there is no non-vegetarian diet that includes your fish byproducts and others. They are being fed to the poultry. So the eggs which are being coming, which they can be called as a true vegetarian eggs. It's supposed to be. Then the organic egg market, it's also been growing. No doubt, the Sikkim is the first state fully organic, but the many zones of the organic meat production as well as the egg productions are they are even coming up in the Uttarakhand region. That's also in Arunachal Pradesh, some of the northeastern states, even including your Madhya Pradesh, as well as even to the Chhattisgarh. So that's also being one of the biggest market. And there's a lot of export potential of the organic eggs are being there, and various certifying agencies are being available, which are being carrying out all this the certification process. Then designer eggs, as I've already mentioned to you, this is a base of the branding of the eggs. How we can nutritionally modify the eggs, not only with respect to the simplest omega-3 fatty acid enrichment or the health promoting components are being added. Even the flavored eggs, we are being adding the natural antioxidants into the eggs, which not only provides the color as well as it also improves the flavor of the product, and we are being also improving the shelf life of the eggs. So these type of the eggs are being the future of the branded market. Various value-added products, they are being coming up. Now you people are demanding the fat-free egg whites, that's albumin, 100% egg protein. They are also being demanding the whole eggs, which are being available in the liquid form, pasteurized form and others, so that they can quantify the properly the formulations. They can quantify the formulations in a proper manner. How much quantity should be added? Because there may be the variation in the quantity of the egg because of the size of the egg being available over there. Then a lot of culture media in which the egg is being used, animal feeds, various egg proteins are being extracted out in the form of lysozyme, avidin, biotin. Even it is being used in case of the artificial inseminations, vaccines, fertilizers, and adhesives. A lot of examples are being coming up. If we see the processing of the egg, no doubt we are being producing 109 billion eggs, and around 79 eggs are being available per capita, per person is being there. But still the processing is being very limited, but their growth rate is being very high. The growth rate of processing of egg is being recorded at around 6.5%. Presently, there are only 5 egg plants are being there, and all these 5 egg plants are being export-oriented units. So they are being EIA, Export Inspection Agency approved units are being there. They are being producing egg powders, liquid, chilled, or frozen egg products also in the form of egg white, yolk, whole, And various value-added egg products are also being coming up. It's also knocking the doors of the market because the future is being regarding the processed egg products. Gadwasu has also worked on those lines, and we have the Raja Fats and Feeds, and they are being our co-partners, and we have established one egg processing plant in Punjab, which are producing the egg powder, egg liquids in the different forms. The various products are being coming up. Then we have various functional egg products also, egg-based jams, egg-based pickles, egg chutneys, and others. Even that's having a high protein, like the egg-based jams. The majority of the jams which are being available in the market, they are being a fruit-based, and they have a 0% protein. Whereas if we are being adding egg into it, it's not only providing the variety, but it also leading to the protein percentage around 14 to 16%. So as the kids, they always like to go for a jams. So this is one of the good variety they can avail for that purpose. We have also developed the cholesterol-free, sugar-free egg jams. Various other value-added products like the egg-based drinks, drink concentrates. We have also developed the egg-based drink concentrates. You can just mix it with the water. One portion is a concentrate and four portion of the water, and you can have an egg drink. Even you can add the carbon dioxide gas into it to produce the fizziness, as in case of the your regular soft drinks and others. But this is being providing them the protein-based drink. The protein is percentage is around 4 to 6%, and this concentrate has a shelf life of more than 3 months at a room temperature condition even. And this, the egg-based drinks, they can be saved at a refrigeration temperature even more than, if it is in a sterilized, even more than 6 months even. The instant egg soup powders. Then from the powders, we are also developing various different ready mixes. That's with the egg bhurji mixes, egg-based your omelet mixes. All these are being there. We have developed some innovative products like egg paneer, egg-based paneers also, and from albumin paneer, albumin-based paneer, which is free from the fat, and it can be used as being our traditional milk-based paneer are being there for preparing any type of the delicacies, any preparation of any type of the snack products and others, and it has a longer shelf life as well. Poultry meat sector, if we see, still there is a lot of traditional meat shapes are being there, but the things are being changing. As you know that the spending capacity of individual is being increasing, and the section by the FSSI is being increasing, awareness is being improving. A lot of people are being moving to the traveling through air, moving to the going for a hotels and others also. The quality is being improving, but there is a long way to go. That's a big question, whether we have been really changing. Only the outside structure is being changed, where the product is being presented or sold out, but still the slaughtering methods are being the same, without any animal welfare issues, without any stunning, without using the other practices. Is it being the same? This is still being a question mark, because there is only 11 to 12% of the poultry birds are being slaughtered in a modern slaughterhouse units. Still the 88% of the is being slaughtered in a unhygienic manner. So outside shops are being, no doubt it's being changed. The presentation has been changed. It's been changing. But still we have to look back whether our backside of our shop is being still being filthy. We have to look for that purpose. If the larger poultry processing plants are being there, which has a capacity of more than 1,000 birds per hour, there's around 21 are being registered. Small poultry processing plant, which has per hour capacity less than 700, is 18. So in these, only 11% of the poultry meat is being slaughtered in these modern units. In this regard, we have in at Gadwasu, we have come up with a model unit. That model unit not only used for the teaching purpose, it's a small unit of 300 birds per hour capacity, and we are regularly generating revenue through it by under the public-private partnership mode. We are ensuring the animal welfare issues. The quality of the meat is being improved. We have developed all the clean and green technologies over there. We have an effluent treatment plant. We have a rendering unit so that we should utilize everything. The basic purpose is that the zero waste technologies. We have implemented the zero waste technologies over there, and our students are getting the industrial exposure, and so that they can be absorbed in the poultry industry in the coming years. If we see how the things are moving up, I'm giving simplest example of the value addition. That's how the cost economic is being there. If we are selling the dressed bird as a whole, it's being, you can say that's a highest way, around 150 to 160 rupees is being sold per bird or per kg. If we divide its simple part, the drumstick or the thigh, breast portion, neck, wings, back. So as per the pricing in the market, you can see that the whole leg, drumstick portion, thigh meat is always being sold at a premium price, whereas the neck and others, they are being sold at a lower price. So if you are selling only preparing the portions of the carcass, the profitability is being increased by 60%. And they are changing, the retail meat sector is changing. A lot of brands are coming up, which are adopting. They are providing all these cut up parts, portion in properly packaged conditions and others are available. And the by value addition becomes more important in case of the our hens. As you the layers, when the laying cycle is complete, then they are how they are disposed. That's one of the biggest issue, because their meat is very tough and the juiciness is low. The acceptability of the layer meat is very low. At Gadwasu, we have developed the technologies which can go for the tenderization. It has the same tenderness as equivalent to the broiler meat, and the juiciness is also improved. Further, we have developed various products, value-added products, which has a quality which can mask all the ill effects of the toughness of the meat. Then we are also pursuing for the functional meat products, how the we can improve the functionality, health-oriented meat products, designer poultry meat products are being developed as per the requirement of the consumers with respect to the low salt, low fat, omega-3 fatty acid enriched meat products, fiber enriched meat products are being there. Then bioactive compound incorporated products like beta carotene and others are being added. Then we have also developed the various poultry meat products with extended storage life. As I've already discussed many times, that there is a fragmented cold chain is being there. So we are developing those products which has a longer shelf life, and they can be preserved at a room temperature conditions for a period varying from 45 days to 6 months. In that lines, meat-based biscuits, meat-based kurkures, meat-based vadis, they are also there, croquettes and other so many snack-based products are being developed, which has a good potential to market, even for the small entrepreneurs. Then we have also developed so many the traditional meat products like the samosas and others, with no doubt it's acceptable, it's prepared by everyone. But the major issue with the samosa and others is also in free fatty acid contents and their shelf life. So we have resolved those issues. We have added the antioxidants into it. So we are providing all these products which are a stress reliever, stress buster products. various others meat products like nuggets, balls, kofta, rolls, pickles, sausages, salamis, patties, and others. No doubt various industries they are being coming up, but we are being basically providing all these facilities to the our small entrepreneurs, those who want to start their unit at a low level, or we are being promoting the small unemployed youth which can come into the this industry. Then the marketing system, we see that in the last few years the online marketing or the e-commerce is being coming up like anything. As you may be knowing, especially in case of the corona crisis and others, online or the internet is being increased like anything. Everything is being coming up, even all online teaching and everything is being going on. So how the online marketing system is has provided a big way to the poultry products. This around 750 million internet users are being there in India presently, as per the survey. And they are amongst them, you can say that 39% of the Indian population is a middle class, and they are ready to experiment. And this is being growing. This e-commerce market is being growing like anything, but this is being major concentration still being towards the groceries and others. We have to look forward how the eggs and the poultry meat can be included into it. For that purpose, we have to maintain our supply chain with respect to not only to the maintenance of the quality, hygiene, so that we can cater both B2B customers and B2C customers, both can be there. And this online marketing system, they are basically can be developed only on two bases. One is the quality, and second one is the convenience which they provide it. So the e-commerce, the baseline of this e-commerce is the quality and the convenience, and it's going to be increased manifold in the next few years, because all this has led to the disruption of all these aspects. Now the marketing system is totally disrupted. During the corona crisis, the grocery shops and other were being closed, hotels were being closed. The food, we see the processed food startups sector, no doubt a lot of startups are being coming up, but majority of them are being limited to the food delivery systems. They are bringing all the restaurants under the one platform. Many of the companies, they have come up with the vending machines also, smart kiosks with respect to the meat product maintain and as well as the egg products. Even in Ludhiana, many people has placed the egg kiosk over there. The other milk egg vending machines are being there, are being placed, so you can get the eggs as per your requirement, 4 eggs, 6 eggs, whatever you are being there. Even on the tray, full tray is also being available under this vending machines. So e-commerce, as I mentioned, lot of meat brands which are being selling their products under the online system, eat marketing, e-marketing systems and others are being there, and it's been increasing, and this market is being increasing. Then I just in the last part of my talk, I want to tell you about the some of the success stories of the egg, especially with respect to the Gadwasu. We have many of the farmers, small entrepreneurs. They are associated with this. Like one of them is the egg-based different recipes are being there. The egg paneer, they are being coming up. Egg cheese is also being there. And they have started their YouTube channel also, where you can check out all the different recipes also. Then we have also gone for the egg drink. Like here you can see that the kiosk of the is being put up over there, and the, that's a regular shaking system is being there, as you have seen on the similar structure, as you have seen in case of the different restaurants, as well as on the your regular bus stations or the railway stations also, they are being selling the fruit based, where the fruit based powder is being available, and that's mixed up with the water, and that's being sold out. Similar is being over here. We can sell out the egg based drinks in these shakers, through these shakers also. then the most popular product in North India, especially in Punjab or this part, is that say the pickle. And the pickle is always, no doubt, it has its own self-life issue are being there, and it can be marketed very easily. So a lot of people are being associated with us, which are being marketing the meat-based pickles, chicken pickles, egg-based pickles, and others are being there. So this provides them the lot of revenues, and we have almost more than 250 entrepreneurs are being associated with us, which are being selling different poultry, meat, and the egg products. Egg-based drinks. We are being conducting regularly Kisan Melas or the Farmers Day at our university level, and we are being providing the sale counters to these farmers or the small entrepreneurs which are associated with this. So they get any confidence of selling their produce over there, and so that they can further, they can improve their marketing skills as well as they can go ahead with their products. Then our jams and the chutneys, they are being even exported out. A lot of meat-based products, different brands which are being associated with us. A lot of technologies we have transferred to the entrepreneurs on the, not only we are being providing them trainings and others also, we are also being the exhibitions, we are showing all these products to the our exhibitions also, exhibits are also being conducting. We are being, as already mentioned, we are conducting almost 5 to 6 training programs on an annual basis for the farmers and the entrepreneurs. We are also conducting trainings for the subject matter specialists also. We have, so that the knowledge can be transmitted to the base level persons. Those are being, every stakeholder should be involved in that process. Our target is that the knowledge regarding the processing, marketing systems and others, it should reach to the everyone. That's the major issue. For that purpose, we are conducting entrepreneurs development programs also on a regular basis. Next, we came up with a lot of pet foods categories also. Many of the byproducts which are coming out from the poultry industry, as well as even to the egg industry, like eggshell and others which are being coming up, how that can be utilized in case of the animal feed. We have developed pet foods that's not only to the breed specific, it's the age specific also pet foods. We are also developed the health or the medicinal pet foods also in collaboration with our Department of Animal Nutrition. And so that we are being also providing trainings to the farmers as well as the small entrepreneurs on the how they can go for the development of the pet food. And as you know, this industry is also being coming up in a very big manner, and the future is being there. How we can utilize all these byproducts in the pet industry and get the maximum profitability. However, still there are the big problems which are being hampering the growth of the poultry market. One of them I already discussed with you regarding the transportation of the live birds under the unhygienic conditions, the animal welfare issue. There is still a lot of high mortality is being there, especially in the summer seasons or when the relative humidity is very high. Then the other issue is the sale of the dead birds. Along with the live birds, dead birds are also being sold out after cleaning up the feathers and others. How it can be resolved? Then quality of the poultry feed which is being given. We have to ensure the quality poultry feed, because that's a primary source of not only the mycotoxins and others, it's also being a salmonella contamination. The residue content in the poultry meat and eggs, which has already I have highlighted. No doubt, the quality of the egg during the storage process, as the egg is being traveling from North India to the South India and different parts of the country, we have to ensure the clean egg production practices so that the self-life of the egg, which is being mentioned in the books, that should be met out, because there is always being an issue with respect to the self-life of the eggs. Many of my colleagues, my seniors, always claim that in the books it is being mentioned like that. But is it true? How the egg quality, high functionality is being changing during the transportation, during the storage, how the pH of the egg albumin is changing, how the pH of the whole egg liquid is being changing, how their functionality is being changing, whether it is being good for the all the bakery industry or the consumers, that other consumers, that's a big question mark. I'm posing this question to the all my colleagues, whether we can ensure the quality of the eggs with respect to all these facts. Then no doubt the bad eggs or the fake eggs, this issue is not being common in case of India, but it has been rocked in India also, and as well as, but still it's been going in China and other parts. So we have to ensure all these issues also. Egg is such a commodity which cannot be adulterated, but we have to ensure that point. Then I'm regarding my recommendations on these aspects, regarding the processing aspects and how we can improve the marketability of these processed products. The most important thing is there, the engineering aspect, which is the most important in case of the processing industry. That includes this slaughtering, dressing, development of the value-added products, plus maintenance of the cold chain and others. It's at the low cost is still being lacking. How the renewable energy, solar energy, can be utilized to develop the low cost egg chillers, meat chillers, or meat to maintain the quality during the supply chain. Low cost processing line for the ready to cook products, ready to eat products, especially with respect to the ethnic products, is also being important. Then low cost cold chain facilities, energy efficient and service system, especially for the support to the small scale production systems. Then effective packaging systems and the lines. We have to optimize the product formulations. We have to develop the novel functional products so that we can improve the variety. We can improve the different marketing systems. The consumer base can be improved. No doubt, the Indian government has introduced many schemes under the Sampada by the Ministry of Food Processing and Industries also, regarding the infrastructure and marketing and others. Still, there is a lot to be done on that aspects also, so that a lot of farmers, especially in case of the corona crisis and others, how the poultry farmers can be compensated, how the system can be improved, because this is an emergent situation. We have to prepare ourselves in the future also, in all these emergent situations, how we can manage. Then availability of the funds or the loans without any bottlenecks is being there for processing industry. No doubt, a lot of schemes are being available in case of the cold chain maintenance, but still if people are being looking here and there regarding the how they can go for the processing part and others. Then we have to go for the generating effective demand for our goods. As I mentioned, few of aspects I've already mentioned, how we can improve the demand. Then still we are being lacking the mass communication and the promotion problems. This has been reflected during the corona crisis by a single rumors, which were being fake rumors, fake news. It has devastated the poultry industry. However, how we can promote that? How we can stop all these nuisance in the future? That's also being important. Our associations should have a big mass communication base and the promotion attitude, so that all these problems can be handled in a much better way in future. Then still we are being lacking the market research problems. No doubt, a lot of integration is being happening in poultry industry. A lot of companies are being coming up. They are being concentrated more on the broiler meat section. Still, in case of the layer industry, there's a lot of scope are being there, but they have to go through the proper market research problem. They have to evaluate the cost of production. They have to go how they can reduce the cost of production by precision nutrition quality, proper genetic resources should be utilized, and how the productivity can be increased. Then how this available produce can be best utilized. Then we have to fill the gaps between the urban-based market and the rural consumers also. Then most important thing is that the still the food testing labs are being lacking. No doubt the private food testing labs are being coming up, but they are being very costly and they are being only the commercial lines and others, they can go for that purpose. Still, our small farmers, small backyard poultry farmers or small units are being looking to the government institutions for testing of their produce as well as their feed also at a low cost. We have to go, all the institutions, they have to look into that category. We should establish the accredited labs at our institution level so we can extend this facility to the small farmers, small entrepreneurs also. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir, for nice presentation, informative.
Thank you very much, sir, for your nice presentation. We are getting overwhelmed response in our YouTube channel, sir. Very informative session, in-depth coverage, very, very informative lectures like that for your presentation, sir. Around 100 to near 200 participants are joined live for the session on YouTube. Sir, this we are doing on YouTube live, as people are doing. So there are some questions, sir. No doubt you have covered all these things, but our audience is diversified. But we are streaming on live, so audience is diversified. So some question is there. So please, sir, we'll take some questions. Okay, sir. Sir, with your permission.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, first question is, in any disease condition like bird flu or corona, live poultry market and poultry is a soft target. It is always affected. So does you see that processed chicken market will help to the farmers or will rescue the farmers in future in such kind of condition? And I'm clubbing one more question, that what percentage of consumer wants processed chicken? This is questions related to processing for the farmers also and for the consumers also.
You have asked a very wonderful question. So no doubt, especially in case of this crisis condition, the processed meat market is a very, very important aspect. As the awareness is being increasing that with the thermal, when we go for the heating of the products and the product is being cooked, then it kills majority of the spoilage and the pathogenic organisms, as well as our viruses also, our product becomes safer. After that, we have to maintain its quality. That maintenance is quality. For that aspect, we have to go for a proper packaging system so that from outside source, there should not be any microorganism should come into the system. So this, your question is being very right. The processed meat industry, processed egg industry, they can save the farmers regarding this crisis. Number two point is that, as you mentioned, regarding the
consumer preference, sir. Consumer preference regarding process market, because most of the market is live bird market. That's why
majority of the market, as I've already mentioned you, that around 88% of the birds which are being sold out, that's a horse meat market, are being there. Only 10 to 12% of the meat which is being sold, that's coming into that we can say that processed meat. That processed meat includes both restaurant as well as the processed in a fast consumer market aspect also, FMCG. But the total, if we see that the processed market is being coming, that's only 2% of the total is being there. But it's been increasing at a very fast pace. And almost as in the last 3 years, the data says there is an increased growth rate is around 12% is being coming up in this processed poultry meat and the egg product market. So there is a future is being there on that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. One more question is there, sir, related to processing. If we increase processing even in today's also byproduct is more byproduct byproduct like feed and other thing is there. In other countries, this is consumed or this is utilized. What will be the future of this byproduct of poultry in case of our India, concerned with our country?
$1 billion question you have asked. So because the byproduct, I always propagate that the byproduct should be utilized in a proper manner, and we should adopt all the clean and the green technologies at our, not only on, only on the poultry farms, but also also at a poultry processing units and others. So the easiest way of the byproduct is development is the our using the smallest rendering plants. By the rendering plants, we can produce the meat meal, bone meal, or like these products are being there. In case of the egg, like hatcheries and others, we can have a hatchery waste meal, we can develop. And no doubt, the rendering plants and others, they are not getting popular comparatively. Only in the modern poultry processing units, where it is being compulsory under the your pollution control norms and others, they are being setting up. But we are being all pursuing with the government and the different sector, like in case of our municipal corporation slaughterhouses are being there. They are also, they also should go for setting up the rendering plants over there, and they are doing it. And the byproduct industry is being coming up. Further, I always propagate that the, we should go for the high value processed byproducts also. Like simplest example is that the, like simply selling the bone meal, we can extract out the osin. And osin is a very high market. Its price is 10,000 rupees. Or the simplest is the gelatin and the glue. Gelatin, which is being utilized by the pharmaceutical industry and the glue, or the maybe the your food industry also. In the last year itself, we have imported the gelatin of worth more than around 7,000 crore rupees. Even I may not be correct in that figure. It may be more even for that purpose. So there is a demand of the gelatin and other these type of the high value processed products are being there. And the basic guidelines how we can go for this utilization of the byproduct. Gadwaso is being providing the training also in that aspect, and we are also being giving the consultancy services at a very very nominal cost to the farmers as well as others also.
Thank you, sir. It means, sir, whatever byproduct is there is product for other industries also, and it has high value, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, one more question is, sir, related to this residues in this poultry. It is in always news is there some residue levels is there. What is the correct information of this residue levels in meat and eggs, sir, of antibiotics? And one question is related to colistrin. No doubt colistrin is banned in India, but the residue of colistrin in the meat.
If we no doubt the residue and always being a maligning the poultry industry is being there. The we have to, the standards are being placed. We have to go for the those standards. That's the most important. That's why we are being propagating that we should utilize the natural compounds. We have conducted a lot of trials with using the natural herbs, even the simplest spices also, cinnamon or black pepper, even turmeric, ginger, garlic. They are also not only improving the productivity, but also improving the flavor of the eggs also. As well as they are also, we have found that the, they also extend the shelf life of the poultry meat as well as the eggs also. We have any data on that cases also, and others are being there. So we always go that we should avoid all the growth promoters, antibiotics and others are being there. On because it's a really very controversial issue, so I don't want to spell on that how much amount is being available, what is that, that's not there, that's not my part of it. Thanks for
it. Thank you, sir. One more question is there related to that. In near future, does this paneer will be replaced by egg white cubes?
Yes, really, sir, it's been coming up in a very nice manner, and a lot of people are being using. The basic problem with that system is being there. That like paneer, milk-based paneer is being, every farmer, every dairy farmer is being producing egg, milk-based paneers and selling at their roadside creameries and others. So same thing, if it happens with the egg-based paneer also, then it, the popularity will be good enough. Whereas no doubt the egg-based cubes or so-called paneer and others, they can be marketed in the FMCG complex of manner also. But for that purpose, we have to look forward its flavor and the shelf-life. Shelf-life is a major issue. So we have developed the technologies to extend its shelf-life also at a low cost. So we are being propagating all those. It will be good in the future. I think so.
Thank you, sir. We are running out of time. I take one last question, then we'll move to next lecture. For a liquid whole egg, right now the era of Tetra Pak is there. So Tetra Pak, how Tetra Pak will help for liquid egg packing? Tetra Pak egg pack.
Yeah, Tetra Pak, we have recommended, no doubt Tetra Pak is being there. We are being even multi-layer different packaging systems are also being developed, even your HDP, high density polythene films, then the our PET bottles and others, they are also being utilized. Tetra Pak packaging system is very costly. For that purpose, you require a lot of capital in infrastructure also. So to in replacement to that, we have recommended that we can go for the multi-layer HDP, as well as or maybe the PET bottles are being, or the cans can be utilized for that purpose.
Thank you very much, sir, for a nice informative session and this answering all the questions of the audience here. Thanks for your valuable time, sir. Our audience is enlightened with your speech. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir, for informative lecture. It is useful for not only the students, but it is from processor to the producers. Lecture covers everything. Sir, for on behalf of NAHEP team, I thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you.
And others, thanks a lot, sir. It's been really wonderful to interacting with all you people, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Moving to our next lecture, that is on disease aspect. We have seen that what happens when disease strike in any thing like corona strike in our country and everything is vanished. So everything is running good in poultry business, except if there is no disease. But disease is always with the life. So for that, we have with us today a renowned personality, Dr. K.S. Prajapati, sir. He is a former head of the Department of Veterinary Pathology, Veterinary College, AAU Anand. Dr. Prajapati, sir, had completed his graduation from this college. And he's a gold medalist during this UG time. He worked on infectious bursal disease in chickens for his master's degree in the college in 1979. He was awarded Vice Chancellor Gold Medal during his master programs in veterinary pathology with ICR Junior Fellowship. He joined lectures in Department of Pathology, Veterinary College, Anand, and completed his PhD on topic of pathological, immunological, and histochemical studies on bovine cancer. Since then, he's continued in the department and reached up to the position of professor and head and retired in October 2004. Sir, a wide experience in the field of poultry disease diagnosis and treatment. He's popular among the students, an ideal teacher, and among the field veterinarians and the farmers for his excellence in disease diagnosis. He had significant contribution in area of poultry pathology, Department of Pathology of the college. Dr. Prajapati sir has guided more than 25 students and 5 PhD students in veterinary pathology. Most of the students work in the poultry pathology. Because of his interest, most of the students work in the, choose the after completion of pathology, general pathology, they choose poultry pathology only. He's published more than 77 research papers in national and international journals of repute, presented 93 papers in various national and international symposia, seminars, 24 popular articles. He is a life member of 4 scientific associations. His contribution in the area of poultry pathology well duly recognized by Indian Veterinary Pathologist IVPA by honoring him an outstanding poultry pathologist award in 1999. His service as veterinary pathologist were also duly recognized by Gujarat Veterinary Association by honoring him with exemplary veterinary awards 2013 for outstanding contribution for the veterinary profession. He is a counselor in the World Poultry Science Association India branch since 2002. He was an organizing secretary of 11th and 31st IVPA conference in 1994 and again in 2014. IVPA offers a confirmed fellowship at the title of Fellow of Indian Association of Veterinary Pathologists, FIAVP, on to Dr. K.S. Prajapati sir for his outstanding contribution to the advancement of the veterinary pathology in India. Association of Avian Health Professional India awarded a Lifetime Achievement Award for this, his service in the field of avian health in 2018. This is a short bio data. There are very more with the Prajapati sir. So I will request Dr. Prajapati sir.
I will request
Dr. Savali sir to welcome Dr. Prajapati sir, and then sir will deliver a talk on the
Sir, I heartily welcome you in the webinar. We all know that Dr. K.S. Prajapati sir is known for all four P. Four P. First P is for his surname. Second, he is a professor. He is a professor. He is a very good professor. He is a very good teacher. And I just learned many things from him. He is my good teacher. Third thing is he is a man from poultry. And fourth is a man from pathology. So 4P, with this 4P, his introduction is, though it is not sufficient, but he is a well-known personality in poultry production and poultry health. So I welcome you, sir, in this occasion. Thank you.
Over to you, sir.
Right, sir. Over to.
Yes, sir. Prajapati, sir, please. Sharing the screen.
Visible screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rajpura and Dr. Savalia, for my introduction. With the grace of God and your well wishes, I am fast recovering from the corona. I just took chance whether I could deliver or speak for an hour or so. But anyway, I will try my level best. But I will go a little slow because I may feel some exhaustion. At the outset, I thank the organizer, particularly Dr. Prambhat, Dr. Pundir, Dr. Savalia, Dr. Rajpura, for giving me this opportunity. Now the topic, economically important disease of poultry, has become so relevant these days that I hardly have to impress upon that how diseases are important, particularly economically. We are passing through a century's worst pandemic of corona, and everybody has realized how a single disease can cause the disasters, not only in the economics, in every walks of life. This happens in the human pandemic, which occurs once in a while in a century or so. But those who are in poultry, they know that we face such problem very, very frequently. Starting from the initial growth of the poultry industry, we suffered with Marex disease, then with the Gumboro disease, then with the inclusion body hydropericardium syndrome, then few sporadic outbreaks of bird flu, then very, very widespread low pathogenic avian influenza, endemic areas of infectious laryngotracheitis. The industry has come out successfully tackling all these problems. You just think, for a while, if you close your eyes, that instead of corona, if it would have a bird flu pandemic, what would happen to the industry? Fortunately, the bird flu H5N1, it has been held up in the nature at one particular stage and has not proceeded to end into a kind of human pandemic. Meanwhile, some bullet trains have passed in the form of SARS, MERS, swine flu, and very recently this COVID-19 pandemic. But ultimately, the industry survived only because of availability of the vaccine. Whether it is a Marex, whether it is a Gumboro, whether it is a IBH, or whatever it is. It's the same situation that we today feel regarding the corona pandemic. We are very, very eagerly waiting for the vaccine, and that is the only solution. So basically, the disease is definitely, they are doing disastrous sometimes and totally ruins the industry. Now, if you saw four pillars in poultry production, profitable poultry production, when you are in a commercial poultry, that basically should have a very good genetic type of bird. And to that, if you provide a good nutrition and management, and if you can control the diseases, probably you can make your business profitable. So basically, it's the genetics and nutrition which is very important. But health, because all these days we are rearing the poultry, and we have learned how to tackle the disease outbreaks. So we try to keep at a minimum the poultry health issues. So somewhere around 7% is the impact of health on the production efficiency. But all this 7% is mainly because of the preventive program, like biosecurity vaccination, whatever we do, that costs. But if the disease strikes, it eats away the profit gained through genetics, nutrition, and management. Everything is lost if the disease strikes. Another important aspect, that the kind of bird which we are dealing is a highly genetically manipulated for the production efficiency. And naturally, the body weight gain or egg production is inversely correlated with the immune function. That means we rear bird in masses, the birds are highly susceptible to the disease, and that's why there are likely chances of having the outbreaks. So there are various areas in which the diseases cause economic losses. Basically, when we say disease, we mean it is mortality. But even the morbidity, when the bird is not eating to the level, or there is a reduced feed intake, naturally it affects the growth rate and the production. And there is a increased culling rate. Another aspect in poultry, that here there is no individual treatment. If a flock of 50,000, and if 50 birds are sick, you have to treat all 50,000 birds. That the unit cost of the treatment may be low, maybe 1 rupee or 2 rupee. But if you consider the entire flock treatment, it becomes a very huge amount. Another thing is, it's not always the disease means deaths. Diseases causes without death, even the production problems. to reduce production. So in case of layers, the reduced end-day production or in-house production, there are issues with the quality, particularly of the size. Then, if you don't achieve because of the disease during the rearing, pullet rearing, the uniformity and the targeted body weight, naturally such flocks never give peak production. Similarly, in the broilers, the reduced daily weight gain, the extended days for the targeted body weight is also economic loss, and the uneven growth is another area of economic loss. If the feed efficiency is reduced due to diseases, so many diseases are there. If you take example of the gut health or the respiratory chronic infections, it reduces the feed efficiency and it causes the increased feed per egg in case of layers, or in case of broilers, there is a increase in the FCR. Then, for a preventive program, because nobody wants the disease outbreak, so the farmer has to spend a lot of on disinfectants, vaccination, antimicrobial, anticoccidial, antimycotoxins program. And from the start of the initiation of the project, you have to keep in mind the diseases, and accordingly you have to plan the construct. You have the concept that disease should not strike on my unit. So whatever structural, conceptual, and the designing of the shared planning, everything, it definitely needs more expenses just to prevent certain diseases. Sometimes diseases, they affect marketing. Just now we had a very nice lecture from Dr. Manish. The health issues, whenever there is any panic regarding bird flu, any panic regarding the antibiotic residues, then the food poisoning related with the chicken product, it affects the market. Whenever there is a bird flu outbreak or Newcastle outbreaks, there is a ban on the export. And sometimes when the disease strikes, mortality is there, the farmers go for a panic selling, and that he has to sell the product at a lower rate. Then we have discussed regarding the poultry processing. Now there is a consumer demand for the antibiotic free chicken production. So if the farmer opt for such kind of production system, antibiotic free or no antibiotic ever chicken production, naturally he has to invest a very huge amount on the biosecurity. If you look to the layer industry and the components of the production cost of the egg, the major junk is the feed cost. And naturally, everybody targets feed to reduce the cost, and ultimately it results into the poor performance. So this is a science and the art of preparing the feed or feed formulation, that it should be least cost. At the same time, it should be the least risk feed formulation. Because when you give a calculated nutrient, and when the bird is sick, whenever there is a less feed intake, then the severity of the disease will increase. This is happening with the protein. We are keeping it the minimum. And when the disease strikes, the protein need actually increase. It's not available. So it's a very, because we don't have any sickness diet. In poultry, we don't have any sickness diet. So with the least cost and least risk feed formulation, one has to work. So when you target the feed for your profitability, then many other issues related to diseases will come up. So naturally, when you increase your 1% hen day production, you can reduce your egg production cost by 3.3 paisa. If you reduce 1% mortality, because generally in the case of layers it may be around 6 to 10% depending upon the heat of mortality, but if you can reduce, instead of 10% till culling mortality, if you reduce by 2%, then you can reduce the production cost of egg from 2.8 paisa. So similarly, the farmer has to be very careful regarding the feed wastage. If per bird 1 gram of feed is wasted, the farmer is increasing the production cost by 2 paisa per egg. So we have the target. When you have any business, particularly layer business, we have the target. And fortunately, though it is a biological system, the performance are almost assured. Even your automobile vehicle may fail as per the manufacturer's indicators, but our poultry bird is so honest. And if you provide the good management, nutrition, and disease prevention, you get the whatever targeted production is there, it is achievable. So one has to monitor the flock for their production, for their bird weight, for their egg weight, and for the mortality. So generally, targets are achievable, but if you see with the overall good management, not best, overall good management, good nutrition, and good disease prevention, the farmer do get near about 5-10% less production, but it is achievable. But if you can make much more efforts, probably one can increase the profitability. The issue is same in case of broilers also. The broiler management is like one day cricket, 20-20. Here, every day, every hour is important. Here the target is fixed. 2.6 kg body weight, then FCR less than 1.6. And the days are also limited, 38 to 40 days. So here also, you can't lose even a day or so to achieve the target. And for that, I think management, disease prevention, and the nutrition is very important. So in broiler also, whatever targets are there, they are achievable. Another important aspect is there, whenever bird take the nutrients, there are certain priorities of the system organs in the body. So naturally, the brain and heart, they are at the highest priority. And the fat, if any excess is there, then only it is available for deposition as fat. And in between, second organ which is requiring nutrition is the priority nutrition is the GI tract. And then you get all performance parameters here, egg production, bone growth, and the muscle growth. If anything happens particularly, because if you take an example of the avian immune system, the more than 50% of the avian immune system is in the gut. Okay. In a normal, healthy gut, when the gut immunity is at the low, so generally it is said that 9% of the nutrients are diverted for the normal activity of the immune system. So it is working at a very low level. But if there is any activated gut immunity, gut health issues are there, or any chronic immunological reactions are going on, or any chronic disease like mycoplasma is going on, then the immunity becomes much more activated. And naturally, this immune system will consume more of the nutrient, and those nutrients will be less available for the production organs. So it is very important that one should take care that the immunology or immunity is at the very base level. So there is a long list of diseases. It's not possible to discuss all, but we can group it into two: the diseases which causes very high mortality, and diseases which are not related with mortality but they are with the production problem. So avian influenza, particularly bird flu, which is a really hanging sword. Then low pathogenic is throughout the country very widespread and rampant disease. The Newcastle, particularly new genotype 13, Marex, Gumboro, chicken infectious anemia, respiratory complex disease, coccidiosis, and bacterial septicemic disease like E. coli, fowl cholera, and pleurum. So this is few which I have listed. Now there are certain diseases which are important for the, which affects the production. The same Newcastle disease which can cause 100% mortality, and same Newcastle disease we may not cause any mortality, but it causes severe production drop. Same issue with the infectious bronchitis, EDS, even encephalomyelitis, oryza, mycoplasma, mycotoxicosis, and the bacterial enteritis. So I selected a few diseases to be discussed. For high mortality, we can have a little bit discussion on the Newcastle, avian influenza, and the respiratory complex disease. And for the production diseases, infectious bronchitis, that is for the layers, and this bacterial enteritis for the commercial broilers. Now, we are passing through a stage of pandemic of new genotype Newcastle disease. That is a genotype 13. Of course, it is not declared pandemic, but it is supposed to be a fifth pandemic in future, that the outbreaks of Newcastle disease with new genotype, that is a genotype 13. And that is happening in the vaccinated flocks. It causes, of course, heavy mortality depending upon the vaccinal immunity. Particularly, the chicks and growers, they are more susceptible. Chicks are most susceptible. Then as the number of vaccination increases, the flock becomes little resistant. And after peak, probably there are no outbreak as such, which causes outbreak mortality. But you find the issues of production drop. Similarly, in broilers, they are highly susceptible. And it causes almost 100% mortality in the broiler flocks. Now, from the clinical signs and postmortem lesions, it is very difficult to differentiate between the older version of Newcastle disease and the genotype 13 outbreaks. You can't make out that whether it is a genotype 7 outbreak or genotype 5 outbreak or genotype 13 outbreak, because the clinical signs and postmortem lesions are similar. So whatever lesion we know regarding Newcastle disease, they are there in the genotype 13 also. You find the ulcerations. Now, very important aspect here, I would like to stress that we do a lot of vaccines against, probably this is the only disease for which we have the largest number of vaccinations. Okay. So we try to keep the bird's immunity guess Raniket at a very high level. In spite of this, we could prevent the mortality, but we are unable to prevent the production drop. Today, whether it is a breeders or in the commercial layers, the very important cause of production drop is Newcastle disease. So if the vaccine immunity is low, it causes 100% mortality. And then the genotype 13 virus is secreted for a very long time. In a vaccinated flock, if you have very good titer, and if the field outbreak occurs with genotype 13, then you don't have mortality, but there is a severe drop in egg production, and the genotype 13 virus is excreted from the flock for less than 10 days. Okay. If you still keep a very strong immunity, you can definitely prevent mortality, you can definitely prevent the drop in egg production also, but still there is chances of some excretion of the field genotype 13 virus. So this will lead to slowly build up of genotype 13 infection in the premises. And whenever they find a susceptible flock in the premise, it causes the outbreak. So naturally, the one way we are trying to protect the production drop to the very strong immunity that is in a green zone. If you can create this kind of immunity, vaccinal immunity, probably you can get rid of production drop. But if you have, with the same vaccination program, this kind of vaccinal immunity, then there are chances of production drop in the flock. So generally, you don't get mortality. But the flock, whenever it is at the peak, the disease strikes, and then there is a drop in egg production, and then the recovery is very slow and it never reaches to the original production curve. Okay. Now this is a very, very great loss. No mortality, but the farmer or from a flock, he may be losing more than 40 in-house eggs. So flock becomes economically non-viable. So the only solution is, for the present, we don't have the genotype 13 vaccine. Of course, kill vaccine can be made available. But then we should have a very strong local as well as systemic immunity with the available genotype 2 vaccines, which we have. The another disease we would like to discuss is on avian influenza. As I told you, that we are so lucky that the bird flu, H5N1, has been held up in the nature at a particular stage, that it has not proceeded further into human pandemic. Still, the disease remains with the bird. Only occasional cases are reported in the human being, but there is no human-to-human transmission, and there is no, for the present, any risk of the human pandemic. Now, probably thanks to the policy of various countries, particularly regarding the stamping out policy or test and slaughter. So this stamping out policy has helped in restricting this particular disease. Okay. Till then, in India, we have some sporadic endemic outbreaks are there, which affects the marketing as well as export of the poultry product. But another very important is low pathogenic avian influenza, which is caused by H9N2, which is endemic in India. It is widespread throughout the country. Each and every corner of the country, villages, they are there. And it is causes a serious respiratory problem. So probably there is much more economic losses due to low pathogenic avian influenza than the bird flu. If you go the past history rapidly regarding the bird flu, which has appeared in Navapur, Maharashtra in 2006, and then it has caused a very high unusual, unexplained sudden mortality. And ultimately, it was diagnosed as H5N1. The important thing is the low pathogenic H9N2. Now, this particular subtype is non-notifiable because it is not communicable, not zoonotic importance. So it is non-notifiable. But in the field, the farmers, they know this disease by various name as variant or VBMD like this. But throughout the country, this is the number one enemy today of the poultry industry. So it affects both commercial layers and breeders and the commercial broilers. And in case of commercial layers, there is something coryza-like symptoms you may find, and there is a heavy mortality. Now, this is the subtype which, other than the respiratory system, affects the mature oviduct. This is a very specific, very pathognomonic, that it affects the mature oviduct and causes the edematous wall edema of the oviduct. And this is one diagnostic feature of this particular subtype. Here also, you will find the production loss. It can strike any time during the laying cycle. And then there is a mortality. Mortality is variable. And then the production may regain. In most of the time, the production is coming back to the normal. But if there is involvement of mycoplasma during this phase, then probably the flock performance becomes poor. During the growing stage, if you have the low pathogenic outbreak, then the flock becomes much more susceptible to mycoplasma, coryza, and such flocks, then the problem comes from the growth rate, the uniformity, and probably you will find less production efficiency during the laying phase. So in commercial broilers, same respiratory lesions and signs are there. But here, with LPI, there are many other pathogens which complicates, particularly the mycoplasma and E. coli, and the mortality increases. So once it starts with the low pathogenic avian influenza, then many other mycoplasma and bacterial organism, they interfere, and it causes a vicious cycle of a disease, which is known as the respiratory complex disease. So the initiation of the disease starts with any of these organisms, and very commonly is with the low pathogenic avian influenza, and then it ends up with the mycoplasma and E. coli infection. So the complex respiratory disease, which ultimately ends into the heavy mortality, and you have to treat for mycoplasma, for E. coli, for coryza, and for the ORT. And probably this particular disease is responsible for the maximum use of therapeutic antibiotics. And that's why it goes against our antibiotic residue issue. So use of minimizing the use of therapeutic antibiotic, if you want, then one has to be very careful in controlling the respiratory complex disease. Another disease which causes the production issue is the infectious bronchitis. It is known for its mutation, and it has even changed the tropism also, from the respiratory to reproductive, to the kidney and the gastrointestinal tract. The pathogenesis depends upon the age at which the infection occurs. If it occurs during the first 2 weeks, then when the flock matures, it causes the issues of false layers, and the flock doesn't reach to the peak. Okay. During rearing period, there is no much effect. The flock recovers. But again, when it strikes during the laying phase, then it causes the production drop, XL abnormality, and the quality issues. So, like LPI in Newcastle, here also, it can strike at any age during the production cycle. So these are some of the issues with the egg quality, the XL deformities, and then there are certain variants of the IB, which is a nephropathic, which causes the visceral gout in the baby broiler chicks and aerolithiasis in the pullets. Now, the flock which has been exposed during the early age, during the first 2 weeks, then there are the developmental defect of the oviduct. Ovary is fully functional, but the oviduct is either hypoplastic or there is no continuity in the development of the oviduct, which results into the accumulation of the fluid, and the functional oviduct becomes a cystic one. And such birds, because of the cystic oviduct, they gain a penguin-like posture. And around 10% of the birds in a flock, you may find with such lesions, and those birds do not produce the egg. Okay. So here, the ovary is normal, but the oviduct is like a short, stumpy, not fully developed. Ovulation occurs. The ova falls into the abdominal cavity, ruptures, get reabsorbed. So there is a recycling of the ova, and that's why it is called the internal layers. And these internal layers, such birds, they become little heavier, nearly 200 to 250 gram, much more body weight than the rest of the flock, and they look like a male. But they are the female. And because of this internal layers, they become heavier. The another area which causes the production loss is of the gut health. Now this is very particularly important for the broiler production, and particularly because of the demand of the antibiotic-free chicken, nowadays the gut health has become a major issue. Why the gut health is so important? In a broiler, only 5% is weight of the intestine compared to the body weight. But the intestine consumes nearly 25% of all oxygen and protein which the bird consumes. The intestine consumes 20%, one-fifth of the gross energy through feed. That means quite a good proportion of the nutrient is diverted for the normal activity of the intestinal epithelium. Why such a high nutrient requirement is there? Because the epithelial turnover is very fast. It is almost every day 25% of the total epithelium is lost. That means every fourth day, the complete epithelium is changed. And because of this, there is a high demand of nutrients. This happens in a normal, healthy bird. If anything happens, any enteritis or any pathology in the intestine, this activity will increase. The turnover time will increase. The proliferation rate will increase. It will consume more and more amount of the nutrient, and less nutrients are then available for the production. So, it was found that in a normal healthy bird also, at a very low level, because after all the food particles, they are the foreign particles. It sets in a kind of inflammation which is called as the metabolic inflammation. It's kind of physiological type of inflammation, metabolic inflammation. So if you keep it under control by certain drugs, which are called as the AGPs, actually, these AGPs, of course, they are the antibiotic growth promoter, but their main function is they are anti-inflammatory. If they have the anti-inflammatory action, then only they become a good AGPs, otherwise not. So it was found that when you add such AGPs, the performance is improved. And that's why the AGP is being used. Now, in the recent scenario, where a lot of pressure on antibiotic-free and the residues are there, so one has to be very careful, has to remove or withdraw the AGPs from the poultry feed. So what happens when you withdraw? It results into the increased gut health issues. It results into the necrotic enteritis and dysbacteriosis. Okay. So necrotic enteritis is nowadays becoming more and more important disease because of restriction on the use of AGPs. So with that, the Clostridial organism and Coxi organism, they create a kind of a enteritis, and ultimately the gut health is hampered. So the intestine with the necrotic enteritis becomes functionally at a very low level. And even the organisms, they may travel to the from intestine to the hepatobiliary cystic, causing the cholangiohepatitis. So inflammation sets in with the bacterial enteritis. There is a thickening of the intestinal mucosa. The undigested food is there in the intestine. There is a vent pasting because of the loose dropping. The running cloaca is there. And you'll find the lot of abnormal fecal material on the litter. So naturally, when there are restrictions on use of AGPs, you have to go for the alternatives. So many alternatives are there, and the farmers, they are using. So for improving the gut health, you have to manage the intestinal microflora and the gut epithelium. And for this kind of the alternatives are being used. The issue with this, that the AGPs are the gold standard. And if you want to replace the AGPs, you have to use more than one alternative. And when you are using more than one alternative, that means it is costing. So it is not as desired as AGP. It is not cost-wise also, it is costlier. And that's why there is some reluctance of withdrawing AGPs and going for the alternatives. But ultimately, as a responsible producer of the human food chain, we have to slowly come to the alternatives. Now to come to the end of my talk, that what should be the future approach for the disease management to reduce the economic losses. So naturally, this proverb is very much suitable to the poultry, that the prevention is better than cure, because the disease prevention is much less stressful and costly than disease control and recovery. So the farmer, we have to farmer has to be very vigilant, particularly on the biosecurity, so that a pathogen cannot reach to the poultry. Even if the pathogen reaches to the poultry, then we have to enhance the host immunity. Okay. So this host immunity, either you can enhance to the enhancing the innate immunity or enhance the immunity by vaccination. So the future is, if you want to have the less disease issues, then we have to rely more on biosecurity, more on hygiene, and more on vaccination. So with this, I end my talk. I'll be happy to answer if any queries are there. Thank you.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. Sir, screen share, please disable your screen share so you can view. Hello.
Hello.
Sir.
Hello.
Sir. Yes. Sir, please disable your screen so end your presentation. So we can see you on screen. Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, very nice and informative lecture, particularly covering this topic, sir. There are 2-3 questions. There are not more questions. Is there, in spite of your sir, your distress health, you have covered and you talk with us. So that is very good for us, sir. So one or two question is there, just I will take, sir. One is related to same antibiotic free poultry production. What is it costlier, and how consumer will accept, whether they have to pay more or not, so please.
Yeah, definitely. Because the system of antibiotic free production is costly affair, and particularly if you are going to observe the withdrawal period, that is important. And then the particular eggs are there. If they are sold during the antibiotic, so probably those eggs you have to discard. So naturally, for farmer to produce antibiotic chicken product is a costly affair. And if the consumer demand is there, they should pay for that.
Okay, sir. So if they want antibiotic free production, they have to pay more, sir.
Definitely.
Thank you, sir. Sir, one more question, because our audience is diversified. So one question is there, which is the best medication for treatment of tapeworm and roundworm infestation in pigeon? So this is a technical pigeon, sir, because our audience is diversified. We are on YouTube live.
Okay.
So pigeon tapeworm.
Generally, levamisole we prefer. Levamisole, 30% levamisole. In pigeons. Then another is the mebendazole, vermin powder is there. But for the tapeworm, probably the intermediate host, those insects. Insects we may have to control. But generally, mebendazole and levamisole, they are the choice of drugs for roundworms as well as tapeworm.
Thank you very much, sir. I will ask Dr. Sawalia, sir, for vote of thanks.
Sir, thank you very much. In spite of your ill health, you have delivered a very long lectures, even very informative and nice lectures. Thank you. Thank you very much for your presentation, sir.
Great pleasure for me also. I just wanted to test my lung capacity, whether they improved or not.
So, sir, get well soon.
Thank you.
Sir, we will wish for your speedy recovery and complete recovery, sir.
Thank you.
Dear participants, today here we end our session to morning session. In afternoon, we will meet at 2:30. We have one round personality in afternoon, that is Dr. Hari Krishna Deka. He will speak on FPOs in community poultry farming through FPOs. Right now, the government is working or looking for the FPOs. So we'll back to you at 2:30. Please stay with us in afternoon. Please join us. And thank you. Have a nice lunchtime.